Hi. I'd like you to meet a friend of ours. Mr. Jim Woodside, whom all of you know, has been active in this community for years and years and years. Boy, the list is long of the things Jim Woodside's been involved in. He was on the Board of County Commissioners. He was chairman for 4 years. He's a president and treasurer for several years of Textile Hall in the 50s and 60s. He was chairman of the board for 5 years. He was instrumental in helping to get Donaldson Center here. He was a trustee of the Greenville Hospital System. He was chairman of the Community Chest. He's been on the board of the Greenville County Foundation and the Furman University Foundation, and he's active with the Greenville Hospital System Foundation. You could go on and on and on about Jim Woodside, but I want him to tell you some of the story, and it's nice to have you, and I appreciate you doing this, Jim, for us.
Thank you, Dave.
I've often wondered about people like you. What is it about you that you choose to be so actively involved as a leader in a community like Greenville?
I can't say that I, at any one time, said I want to be a leader.
Just sort of happened?
I just grew up to think that Greenville was just a great place. The Greenville papers stirred that within me, I guess. And not only that, but when I was just a little boy, for some reason, the Atlanta Journal started coming to our house. And I would read it religiously and saw what was going on down there. And I guess that was really an inspiration to me.
You talk about when you were a little boy. That's no secret to the folks here tonight.
No, that was some years ago.
Yeah, no secret to the folks here tonight. You're 83 years old, born in 1903.
That's right.
What was Greenville like growing up in the teens and even before that? What was downtown Greenville, where your home was, like in those days?
Well, we lived only three blocks from Main Street. Mm-hmm. And we were right in the center of things. I was also only three blocks from the Central School, which was the high school at that time. And there were two other schools in Greenville then, Park and Oak Lawn. Mm-hmm. But we walked everywhere. And of course we had our bicycles and skates, but we never expected anybody to carry us anyplace by vehicle. And right there in the heart of town, my father usually kept one or two horses. And we always had a cow. And of course, part of my growing up duties was to help take care of that cow.
Of course, yes.
And probably the people here now don't know what cottonseed meal is, but it was what we fed the cow. And it's gold dust. And when it gets on a blue serge suit, it's almost impossible to get it out.
And that happened once in a while.
It happened every Sunday.
Just about as bad as red clay, right?
That's right.
Yeah. What'd you do for games and fun in those days?
Well, we had our friends in the neighborhood. And we played from morning till night. We were only two blocks from the Woman's College. It was called the Greenville Female College then. Mm-hmm. And Dr. Ramsey, the president of the college, had two boys who were comparable in age to my brother and myself. And we could always play tennis on the college tennis courts. Mm-hmm. So that's what we did a good part of the time. And then the fellas that we grew up with, I think, were right creative in their activities. We were across from the Buncombe Street Methodist Church, where they had some big oak trees, and you could always get up an acorn battle or something like that.
It was pretty good in the growing up years. You had
it
fun,
was good
fun in the Woodside
up.
Family?
What's that?
Fun in the Woodside family?
Oh, yes. I was the youngest of six children. Uh-huh. And they looked out for me pretty well. I think some of them thought that I was sort of a pet, but I deny that. I carried my weight.
You did some interesting things for entertainment in those days. I guess the circus came through on a pretty regular basis.
The circus came through regularly. one year it would be Ringling Brothers, and the next year it'd be Barnum and Bailey. Yeah,
before they got together.
Before they got together. And we had a friend who was high up in the railroad, and he got passes from the management of the circuses, so he always made them available to his two sons and ourselves. Usually there would be 15 or 20 children in the neighborhood going to the circus together.
Because that was a real high point of the year in those
days.
That
was a real high point, and then we would start planning in advance as how we were going to get down to see the circus unload.
Uh-huh. And that was where the old Southern Railway Depot is now?
Part of the time, and then the rest of the time, it was over on what's called College Place on Augusta Street.
Okay.
Mm-hmm. We would plan ahead. We didn't have lamps for our bicycles, but you were required to have a light. And so we would plan ahead how we were going to put a candle in a tin can to light our way to see the circus unload before day. And it was, the circuses then, were, I guess, they were just as great as they are now.
Sure.
They couldn't maybe do but two somersaults, and they do three now.
You live just down the street from the old opera house.
That's right.
And a lot of folks from the big cities came to Greenville to play in those days.
There were a lot of the major plays, and some of the actors I have read about since. I didn't know they were so famous then, but I remember one was DeWolf Hopper.
Mm-hmm.
And I think his play at that time was The Better Old, which was a World War I play, I guess. And the Al Fields Minstrel would come through every year and play there, and would always put on a parade down through Main Street for the show. And then Coburn's Minstrels would come.
Mm-hmm.
And there were hardly a week went by, but what there was a New York play there.
And one time, I believe, or a couple of times over at the old Textile Hall, you saw John Philip Sousa and his band.
John Philip Sousa was there, and I was there too. Walter Damrosch was here with the New York Philharmonic.
With the whole orchestra.
The whole orchestra, yeah. And I had the privilege of ushering for that, so I got in free. Textile Hall furnished an auditorium for Greenville for a number of years, and all of the major events like that used Textile Hall.
Which is a good lead in to talk to you a little bit about your involvement in two major facilities that have been built here in recent decades. One, of course, is the new Textile Hall, which I want to talk to you about in a minute. And the other one is the County Courthouse, which sits at the corner of East North and Church Street. And I believe you were, the chairman of the County Commission in the days when
that was built?
I was
the chairman of the County Commission when that was built.
Mm-hmm.
As I've told you before, I don't take credit for the county courthouse. We had some good commissioners. I was present when it was done. And Senator Williams was really the man that, I think even he selected the site.
But you've lived through four county courthouses.
I've lived through four county courthouses. It was the first one, was the record building, which we all deplore the passing of.
Mm-hmm.
And the next one was a French chateau type thing.
Now you have an interesting story about that one.
My father was the county treasurer at that time, so I had a good many connections with it.
Yeah.
And that was in the days of, there was a good bit of bootleg whiskey made up in the county. And I don't think the federal government was interested in that, but the county sheriff's force would cut those stills, and they would confiscate whiskey and bring it down. And it seems to me that there was hardly a time when there was not some there being poured out in the street.
Leaving a great spell in the air.
That, together with the fact that there were no public restrooms, and the courthouse belonged to everybody, and when they came to town, they expected to use the facility.
Why, sure.
And as a result of that, I think I can still catch the oil of that old courthouse.
Old French courthouse.
That's right. Interesting.
How did you get involved with Textile Hall?
Well, I had known Mr. Serene, W.G. Serene, who was the lawyer,
right,
and a brother of Mr. J.E. Serene, the engineer. Had several contacts with him. And Bertha Green was the secretary of Textile Hall, and after World War I, the things were at a pretty low ebb, and it was difficult to get the show back on the road, so to speak. But Bertha and some Greenville directors persisted. And finally, they decided that they were going to have the show. Some of the exhibitors from away from here resisted some, but the Greenville directors were loyal to it and said, well, we'll put it on anyway. And they asked me, Mr. Serene was beginning to show signs of age, and they asked me to go down and stand by just in case there was a collapse of any kind, to give Bertha Green what assistance I could in putting on that show and seeing that it was staged. So I was a little bit like the man who came to dinner. I went for just a brief spell and stayed 20 years.
And during that time, you oversaw the building of the new Textile Hall and the expansion of all of that Textile Hall into pretty close to what it is today.
Well, of course, some of the expansion came after I severed my connection in 71,
yeah,
something like that. But yes, and we did it in a way that it would just be unheard of today. We didn't hire a consultant to tell us where to put it.
Mm-hmm.
We decided that it would be a good place out there next to the airport. And we acquired that property. And there was no problem after that. And of course, it's privately, not privately, but it's a public corporation. But the city and county are not concerned. The general public is not. And so we didn't have many people looking over our shoulders.
Mm-hmm.
We decided this was a good place. It was a good place to, and the price was right. And if we couldn't use it, we could always cash it in. So we moved ahead. And the only study that we had made in advance of that was a traffic study. We were a little bit afraid that being off of the 291 and having only, at that time, one entrance to it, we would have a bottleneck. So we did have a traffic study made to be sure that we could move the people in and out. And I think it was all right, because during the Billy Graham crusade later on, when we had these two services in the evening, we had to move one group in while we were moving the other one out.
I remember that, 1966.
Yes. And I don't think we had serious traffic jams at that time.
Well, your decisions during those years have worked well, and that's been a great asset for the community, hasn't it?
Yes, I think it's been a big thing for the community.
Another thing that we've built in the last two or three years here in Greenville is a baseball stadium, and I guess that's sort of a monument to the fact that hasn't Greenville always been a pretty good baseball town?
I think it has, because it goes back to the days of Joe Jackson and Ty Cobb.
Uh-huh.
Joe Jackson, of course, grew up in Greenville, and Ty Cobb was through here, I remember, on one occasion when there was a motorcade from Atlanta to promote the National Highway,
mm-hmm,
which is the road from Atlanta to Charlotte. We've had four baseball parks that I can remember, and probably some more. This one, well, I won't try to describe them in detail, but one was out Augusta Street at the Grove Road.
Mm-hmm.
And the first one was on Memminger Street, right across from the General Hospital. And then there was another one on Augusta Street, Graham Field, which was a part of the old Furman University campus. And that is, we had a sports writer in Greenville at that time by the name of Scoop Latimer.
A lot of people in this room will remember him, I'm sure.
I'm sure they'll remember Scoop. And he had a label for things that was different from others. He was a great fellow. And he named that one Peden's Pasture because of Mr. Peden, a photographer, owned the land next to it. And when the ball would get knocked over the fence, he'd say, it's gone to Peden's Pasture.
You had another famous person who came through Greenville pretty often, I guess. FDR came on the way from Washington to Warm Springs.
He was through here a number of times, and of course his body was brought back through here after his death at Warm Springs. And I remember on one occasion Woodrow Wilson came through here and shook hands with everybody at the back of the train. Mm-hmm.
You told me in discussions before this program that you thought Camp Sevier was one of the most, maybe the most important thing that happened in Greenville in the decades past. Why do you think that?
Well, of course, don't leave out the surge of textile construction.
Sure.
From Captain Smythe's day on down. That was the most important thing.
Sure.
But in my time, and the single thing, I think, was the coming of Camp Sevier. And that was provided by public-spirited citizens. I don't know that they gave the land to the government, but they got out and raised it. And of course, that was out on the Spartanburg Road, you know where that is. It was a great influence. One, it brought in the payrolls, for one thing. And the other, it brought in so many fine people, many of whom stayed to become the leaders in this community.
You've also told me about the business climate way back when you were getting started in the business world, and some observations about business and the lack of capital in the years after the Civil War, and really stretching what, up into the early 30s in this town?
That's my impression, that it stretched up that far. Of course, I can't comment on the economics of our area at that time because I'm not a professional. But I've been told that there were not too many pools of capital available for development in Greenville, and that the promoters or they had to go to the centers of capital. And Richmond was regarded as our center. And a good many of the mill men made their trips to Richmond for financial means.
And then I guess in later years it became Atlanta.
Yeah, well, it really went to New York because that's where all the selling agents were, and they did the financing of the mills. But I'd say the financial activities went to Atlanta from Richmond, although there's still a good bit up in that direction.
We still have a pretty, we now have a pretty active Chamber of Commerce that's out getting industry, and a Convention and Visitors Bureau that's out getting people to come to Greenville. You remember when there was a different kind, a different way of going about all that with these booster trips.
I was not old enough to make those booster trips, but I'd like to have made them. Mr. Bill Timmons was head of the Chamber of Commerce at that time. And I don't know whose idea it was, but he promoted them. But each year, they would get up what was called a booster trip. And usually they would charter a car or two on the railroad. And one year, a whole group from Greenville would go, and they would carry some entertainment along with them. And it was sort of like a medicine show. They'd get to town and put on the entertainment. And usually the local people, I think, would feed them at least one meal while they were there. And they just had a grand time. They went to, I remember one trip, they went to Cuba even.
Is that right?
Yeah.
But they built some goodwill, maybe got some visitors
yes,
to come?
Yes, and they went down into the deep south and also up north of here. I don't know how many of those there were, probably half a dozen.
Jim, you've looked at this city a long time, lived here, been a part of it, been a leader in it. As you look at all the changes that have occurred and the difference in Greenville from the 80s to when you grew up early in this century, what do you think as you look at the city and the directions that it's headed?
I think it's headed just like it's always been, just forward. And I have said many times that there's nobody pulled for Greenville to become a city any more than I have, and at the same time hate to see it become have city ways, and that you have to stand in line for things like that. But that comes with progress, and we'll find a way around that.
I guess it's interesting for you to see the cycle go from people living downtown as they did in your day to it becoming just a shopping area. Now it's heading back and people are moving into the downtown area again. That must be an interesting cycle for you to observe.
Well, it is. I don't know how far that'll go, because I think people's living arrangements have changed so that, and public transportation and things like that will affect all of that. But Greenville is, I think it's gotten on a plateau now that it'll always move forward.
Jim, our time is up already, and I appreciate your taking the time and coming to the TV studio and doing this interview. We all appreciate what you've done for Greenville and what you've meant, and wish you many more happy years.
Thank you, sir. I just appreciate your having this much interest in it.
Thank you. Jim Woodside.